Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, this is part two of the creation of a woman from a rib or not. Back to Ka'b the rabbi. As I mentioned earlier on, that Ka'b, out of the seven big narrators of the hadith of Rasulullah, four of them were his students. The chief student of Ka'b the rabbi was Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. Abu Huraira is also a personality that Rasulullah took under his wing for 21 months. I.e. Abu Huraira only lived with Rasulullah 21 months, not even 2 years, just like 1 year and few months. But Umar in his life, even at the time when Rasulullah was alive, had already beaten Abu Huraira for reporting the hadith. The hadith is in al-Bukhari and Muslim, when Rasulullah ﷺ entered a well and he said to Abu Huraira, go out and tell anyone you find that whoever believes in Allah and a few other things, he will enter Jannah. When Umar heard that, he smacked Abu Huraira on the chest and told him, don't tell that to Muslims, they will become lazy. Anyhow, long story short. But also, which is very important in this topic here, is that Umar had already warned Abu Huraira not to mention the hadith of Rasulullah. Umar was a very, subhanAllah, the Sahaba at the time were something made of gold. Umar used to object the narration of hadith. He only wanted people to stick with the Quran. Abu Bakr did the same thing. Umar did the same thing. Uthman did the same thing. Ali did the same thing. All the Sahaba were in total favor of the Quran and the Quran alone. This is why they did not write one single hadith. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq had one day compiled about 500 hadiths and then he burnt them all because he was scared that he would say something that Rasulullah ﷺ didn't say. So Abu Huraira is again a chief in these types of hadith. And as I said, Umar had threatened Ka'b the rabbi that if he doesn't stop, he will exile him to the land where the monkeys live in the mountain. And he did the same thing to Abu Huraira when he said to him, لَتَتْرُكَنَّ الْحَدِيثِ. It's either you abandon the narration of al-hadith, أَوْ لَأُلْحِقَنَّكَ بِأَرْضِ Dawes, or I will exile you to the land of your tribe Dawes, away from al-Madina, very from al-Madina. This is by Abu Zara al-Dimashqi, and the chain of narrator, isnaduhu sahih, it's a chain of narrator, is authentic. So as you can see, my dear sisters and my brother, that Umar was absolutely right in what he saw. The narration of the hadith will cover the importance of the Quran if given time to do so, and what he feared became our reality today. He is absolutely incredible that the man who spent only about 21 months, that is Abu Huraira, in the company of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ends up being the biggest narrator of the hadith ever. And people that Aisha, our mother Aisha, she got married to Rasulullah ﷺ and lived for years with Rasulullah ﷺ, and she didn't beat Abu Huraira. Abu Bakr, Umar, and Ali is, since the age of 6, has lived with Rasulullah ﷺ and he's got less than 200 hadiths. That's how politics play in the Islam we get today. So Abu Huraira lives only 21 months in the thousands. Subhanallah, yani it's unbelievable. But the thing also gets even more complicated when we speak about Abu Huraira. Do you know who Abu Huraira is? Well, guess what? Abu Huraira is a very controversial personality, but that controversy has been taken away and has been and another form has been given to us so that we accept Abu Huraira with nothing at all. Why do we call him Abu Huraira? Why don't we call him by his name? Rasulullah ﷺ has given nicknames to other people. To Ali has given Abu Turab, to Umar al-Faruq and all these things, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Why wouldn't Rasulullah ﷺ call them with their nicknames? And why is Abu Huraira only, we know him as Abu Huraira? The truth of what you are going to hear is going to shake you to the core. And I'm not going to say it from myself. Let me report what Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, a great scholar for both of hadith and biographies, in his great book of Siyar A'lam al-Nubala, and this is the magnificent biography of great people that have lived. What he has done, Ali Rahmatullah, he has taken every companion, scholar, political figure, everyone that existed since Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam until his time, and documented them in a book of like encyclopedia of 20 volumes, big volumes. What he says about Abu Huraira is unbelievable, and this is in all the books of history, biographies of Abu Huraira. He says, اُخْتُلِفَ فِي اسْمِهِ عَلَى أَقْوَالٍ جَمَّةٍ. There is a huge disagreement about the name of Abu Huraira. And then he says, so many hypotheses were mentioned. أَرْجَحُهَا عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنُ سَخْرٍ. The best of these hypotheses, assumptions, is that his name is عبد الرحمن, son of Sakhr. And then he says, ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ ثَمَنِ إِحْتِمَالَاتِ تَحْتْ قَوْلُهُ وَقِيلَ وَقِيلَ. And then he mentioned 8 probable names, saying, and it was said his name is this, and his name is this. What he's telling us is, Abu Huraira, this man with this title, we don't actually know his true name. There are 8 probabilities, and actually there are more than that, where the scholars say, probably his name is this, perhaps it's this, maybe it's that, no, it's this. We don't know the name of Abu Huraira. We only know this Abu Huraira, and this is why they call him Abu Huraira, is because it's a cover-up, because we don't know his name. La ilaha illallah. And since they have no clue about his real name, they absolutely have no clue about his life prior to coming to Al-Madinah. And we have no clue where he's from, what he says, absolutely nothing about the life of Abu Huraira, except what he himself chooses to tell us. And as the proverb goes, he who comes from afar is master of his story. If someone comes from somewhere where we can't double check, he can tell us about anything and we will believe anything. Abu Huraira was over 30 years of age when he entered al-Islam. I do not wish to turn this talk about Abu Huraira and Ka'b the rabbi, but since both of them have played a huge, big part role in the hadith, you need to know where you're taking your Islam from. These two men are in particular a big point of controversy. There are books that have been written against Abu Huraira. Other books have been written in favor of Abu Huraira, and the battle still goes on. It is well known, as I said earlier, that Umar has already beaten up Abu Huraira at the time of Rasulullah, and he did that later on because he was so anti Abu Huraira telling the hadith. Abu Huraira, after Umar beat him up in his time, stopped narrating the hadith when Umar was alive. But as soon as Umar was killed, Abu Huraira later on refrained. And there is a great controversy, as I said, on the roles he plays with Muawiyah. It's a big, big, big headache. But inshallah, one day I will dedicate one whole talk about Abu Huraira only and what he did, and so that you can understand why people are extremely reserved when it comes to taking the hadith from Abu Huraira and things like that, and why the Salafis are so hardcore, making everything to make Abu Huraira as an angel. And between these two extremes, there is truth that lingers out there. The great confusion that you experience in your life, my dear sisters and my brothers, is not of your fault. You see, when many companions used to sit and learn from Ka'b the rabbi, some of these companions, such as Abu Huraira, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, they used to have students as well. And since these companions have students, let us listen to what one of the followers of the companions, one of those students of Abu Huraira, had to say. His name is Bashir ibn Sa'id or Bisr ibn Sa'id. It doesn't matter the name. What matters is him, what he said. And this here is also in Al-Dhahabi, in the Siyar Alam al-Nubala, the biography of great people, and also in the introduction of Sahih Muslim. When Muslim wrote his book, the Hadith, he put this story as an element, as you will see why he did that. This great man says, اتقوا الله وتحفظوا في الحديث. Be mindful of Allah and observe caution and care when narrating the hadith. فوالله, I swear by Allah, لقد رأيتنا نجالس أبا هريرة. I have witnessed us sitting and listening and learning from Abu Huraira. فيحدث عن رسول الله ويحدثنا عن كعب. And he used to narrate a hadith to us from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and from Ka'b the rabbi. So he would tell them both a hadith. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Ka'b al-Ahbar said. So simultaneously, or he says here and then. And then he says, فَيُحَدِّثُ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ وَيُحَدِّثُنَا عَنْ كَعْبِ الْأَحْبَارِ ثُمَّ يَقُمْ. Then when he finishes narrating from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Ka'b, when he finishes, he would stand up and goes. He doesn't double check with his students what they learned or anything. He just tells them and entirely up to them to take or forget or whatever. And then the man carries on, and this is the danger he gets. فَأَسْمَعُ بَعْضَ مَنْ كَانَ مَعَنَا. And then I would hear some of those who were present with us, يَجْعَلُ حَدِيثَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ عَنْ كَعْبٍ. They would associate the hadith of the messenger of Rasulullah ﷺ to Ka'b, i.e. they will narrate the hadith as if it is Ka'b, the rabbi who said it. وَيَجْعَلُ حَدِيثَ كَعْبٍ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. And they would narrate the hadith from Ka'b, the rabbi, as if it came from Rasulullah ﷺ. The student got confused. And it is those students that relate the hadith to Al-Bukhari and Muslim and document them. So you see, when the chain of narrative gets X told B told da, 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 and then they come to a student from Abu Huraira. So the student will say what he heard, but the student has already mixed that what Ka'b the rabbi said and he associated to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is very possible that in one of those settings, Abu Huraira came out to teach the students and he told them that Ka'b al-Ahbar said that in their Bible they have this, that a woman is created from a rib. And then he told other hadith, and one of the students mixed up the two issues, and then he said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that women blah blah blah. You see what I mean? Now, here is another thing that is really, really disturbing. Again, Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi, a very reputable, reliable source of information and knowledge, a great scholar of hadith, one of the students of Ibn Taymiyyah, so and a good friend of Ibn Kathir, Ibn Qayyim Jawziyya. So this man is really an authority in what he does. In his book, when he spoke about Abu Huraira and Ka'b al-Ahbar, Ka'b the Rabbi, he said something really, really to me is very disturbing. He said, مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا لَمْ يَقْرَأِ التَّوْرَاتِ. I have never seen anyone that didn't read the Torah, that is the book of the Jews, هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا فِيهَا مِنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَة, that knows what's in it than Abu Huraira. فَقَدْ كَانَ يَكَادُ يَحْفَظُهَا. He nearly memorized the whole of the Torah. I will say it now a whole time in Arabic and then in English. مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا لَمْ يَقْرَأِ التَّوْرَاتَ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا فِيهَا مِنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ فَقَدْ كَانَ يَكَادُ يَحْفَظُهَا. Now in English, I have never seen, and this is the testimony of Ka'b the rabbi, I have never seen anyone that didn't read the Torah knows a lot of what's in it than Abu Huraira. He nearly memorized it. I really, really, really wish that Abu Huraira did not do what he did, and neither did the other companions, and that is to report to us and narrate to us from what Ka'b the rabbi said and mentioned. It has greatly messed up tons of the knowledge that got to us, namely the hadith and also the tafsir of the Quran. And this has had in the past, still is having to these days, a heavy weight at every level in our sociological, philosophical, and in matters of creed and everything. The impact of Ka'b the rabbi are immense, far more than you can think of. And many of great signs of the hour, many of the things that will happen on Judgment Day, many of the things about the creation of our father Adam, and come from him. But now they are part of our heritage in the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. So Abu Huraira and Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhum, Allah be pleased with them, were in total love with what Ka'b al-Ahbar taught them. And even if these biblical teachings contradict the clear Quranic text, we still find in the hadith, we find these teachings in a hadith. And they were used to explain the text of the Quran. And this is how the explanation of the scholars, and hadith took precedence over the Quran. And of such calamities is this idea of the woman is created from a rib, and I call it a disaster because it contradicts the Quran, and our scholars don't see any problems with it. Even when I was researching this topic here on the internet and all around, even on YouTube, Zaki Naik is there with a bunch of people, and he explains why a woman is created from a rib, and he goes and elaborates, and he says, I'm a medical doctor. And to me, it's far mind-blowing. A medical doctor cannot see the difference between a human created from the dust and a human created from a bone. My dear sisters and my brother, there is a huge portion of the Islam that we have today amongst us, either in books of hadith or tafsir or books of history, fiqh, jurisprudence, and all these things. Sadly, these external parasites that came from Kaab the rabbi and other things are infesting our Islam. This is why we Muslims today are in total loss and fogginess. Well, the Quran says something, the hadith says something, the scholars say something, everybody is saying something, and we are just in the middle of it, like the two peas that a child has just spun, and we are turning on a very, very smooth surface with no end of when we are going to stop spinning. It's very devastating. The ideology of a woman created from a rib has created a very abusive and oppressive world for women in general. And until today, Muslims believe firmly that women can only be followers to men. Yet the Quran has openly declared that the male and female are equal in both the creation. Yes, we have the different parts of us that are different, but that is none of our business. That's how Allah designed us. That's how He created us. We have no say in what, how we look and all those biological features that we have that are different from each other. Other than that, we are both humans, the same humans, equally the same to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And sadly, so as I said, this existence is openly challenged and rejected by Muslims and scholars and anyone that claims to be a Muslim, because they carry the belief that a woman is created from a rib, and not only from a rib, but the left one too. The Bible declared that woman was made from the bottom left rib, and this has put the female in a very bad position, because the left side is considered to be demonic and diabolical. It's Satan. He eats with the left hand. He does everything. He dresses. He does everything with the left hand. And we Muslims sadly do have the same belief, even though it's Allah has given us both sides. And you can check my talk about using the left hand to eat and things like that. It's on YouTube. But anyway, so they believe that anything that does with the left side is demonic, devilish, satanic, and all that kind of stuff. While the right side stands for the good, the righteous, the angelic one. This is why when you say somebody, hey, how are you doing? They say, I am all right. What they mean all right, it means they are, I'm good. And left has always got that negative connotation in that. Heartbreakingly and very sad, the concept of a woman's creation from the left side has also found its way in our religion, in our books of the tafsir, in the hadith, and la ilaha illallah. It's unbelievable. Countless books, including that of Ibn Jarir al-Tabari alayhi rahmatullah, who is considered the top, best, most comprehensive in the tafsir books. And Ibn Abi Hatim, also a great scholar, but predominantly Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, who is today the foundation of the tafsir out there. In Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, he mentions that Abdullah ibn Abbas, again a student of Ka'b the rabbi, so he used to learn from Ka'b al-Ahbar, has explicitly said that the woman, the wife of our father Adam, was created from the left side of a thoracic body, the cage, and at the far bottom rib, and that Allah took it and replaced it with flesh, exactly as the Bible said. For your information, my dear sisters and my brothers, as I said, Abu Huraira spent 21 months with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he spent a staggering 45 years with Kabul the rabbi. That is 21 months with 45 years friendship with Kab the rabbi. Now that we have established the abnormality of the woman created from a rib, let us go see what the beautiful Quran says about how Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala himself, the creator, what he says when he set out to create the beautiful being of the female. The very woman that when a man falls in love with her, openly and unreservedly declares to her saying, my life had no meaning whatsoever until I met you. And only those who have truly fallen in love with a woman know what a great thing to say to a woman. What a feeling when in love, that feeling of a woman provides for the man when he comes home to her world, when she makes his world as calm as perfect. It's absolutely fantastic to come home emotionally, physically, to a woman that is there, that anchors the man that is volatile. We men are just volatile. We cannot anchor ourselves. Once we get married, we anchor ourselves. That beautiful thing that the woman provides, that it gives us that absolute pleasure to embrace that woman that Allah created. He didn't create her any less than the man. She has a function. She's got a beautiful function in this life. And what a great thing for a woman to hear a man feel and say those beautiful things to her. But we Muslims, we hardly ever marry for love. We always, always marry for easiness. Practicality is just what they get the hand on. From a single being, min nafsin wahida. Earlier on, I mentioned that an ayah in the surah number 4, surah An-Nisa, and as I said, An-Nisa does not mean the women. It means the deferred, something that comes later on. But anyhow, in surah number 4, in the first ayah, Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O you human people, اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة, who has created, be mindful, dutiful to your Lord, who has created you from a single entity. And then خلق منها, and from her, he created from her, her partner, her spouse, her double. And then from both of them, he, Allah تبارك وتعالى, has imitated and created many men and women. And I also mentioned that the majority of scholars agreed that the first being created was Adam, and then came from him his wife, and then from the two, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala created many men and women. And I pray to Allah that you remember this. If you don't, just forward back and you'll hear at the beginning. So, but now, let us look at this ayah, into this ayah. Let us look a little bit deeper than what has been said. Okay, away from any presumptions. Let's look into the ayah. Let's study it as if we've never ever heard anything that says that a woman was created from a rib. This is extremely important. If you want Al-Quran to truly guide you, and if you want Al-Quran to truly show you the right path, and if you want Al-Quran to really talk to you, you must study it with a complete empty cup. No hadith, no sayings of scholars, absolutely nothing. Just as the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions did, you receive it on a clean slate. Receive it with an open, clean, clear, and thirsty heart. Ready? Let's go. A general call from Allah to mankind. Ya ayyuhan nas. And as I said, this comprehends men and women, both equally and fully spoken to by Allah. This is not, hey man, then women. This is not you man first, women second. This is man and women at the same time, at the same level. This is a man, both the female and the male together. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks like this in general, you people, He means 100% equally between the both sexes. when he says ittaqu rabbakum, be mindful and dutiful and responsible, acting in fairness and correctness in obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is not saying Allah is more of a God to man and less of a God to women. This is absolutely untrue. Allah is equally the God of man and women equally. He is not more of a God to women, to man, and less of a God to women. This is very important. And then he says, الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجًا. He created you from a single entity, and from that single entity, he created a zawj. In Arabic, the term or the noun zawj is actually always referred to in Al-Quran for both man and women. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to our father Adam alayhi salam, as soon as the angels prostrate to him, Ya Adam, uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah. Adam, inhabit and live you and your partner. So the zawj here is, zawj in Arabic, it means twice. It's the double. It's the pair. So it's like saying, you Adam, live with your pair. A pair of shoes, my dear sisters and my brothers, is not a pair unless and until both shoes, both parts of the shoe are made with the same material. They are the same color. They are the same size. They are the same type of shoes. Then you can call them a pair of shoes. If they are not, you just call them one shoe. So the same thing here, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to us as in zawj, the term zawj is always used for both man and women. It does not mean this or that. Okay, always keep this in mind. Now let us look at the term nafs, because these two words are what holds the key to who was created first. So zawj can be used for both man and women equally. Now a nafs is wrongly translated in the books of tafsir or books of English by soul. It does not mean soul. Sometimes it means self, sometimes it means person. But as a whole, nafs in Arabic is anything that breathes. Anything that breathes is called nafs. So when Allah says, Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut, every soul, they say every soul shall taste death, this is a wrong translation, because animals do not have souls. They have life in them. They do not have souls. Only Allah blew the soul in Adam. The only ones that have a soul are humans. Anything else do not have a soul. So what does kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut, i.e. anything that breathes shall taste death. Will a walsh taste death? No, because it doesn't breathe. But will any animal out there, fish, tiger, birds, anything, humans, taste death? As long as they breathe, they shall taste death. And this is the beauty of Al-Quran. So the term nafs is always used in the feminine form. Either it refers to a male or to a female. So saying surah number 4, ayah number 1 refers to the man first, the woman second, is untrue, because both words are used equally for both souls. Okay? So to really understand this ayah, because it's very ambiguous, we can't reach anything tangible from this ayah alone. And it is really, really strange that our scholars for the last 14 centuries have not paid attention to these small details. So to really understand this ayah, let us look into the book of Allah, since it is self-explanatory. If there is another ayah or other parts in Al-Quran that can help us uncover the meaning of this particular ayah in the fourth surah. The good news is, yes, there is another surah. And this surah or this ayah is in Surah Al-A'raf, that is surah number 7. And then we will see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in there. In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدًا. Again, this is an almost twin sister to the ayah, to the surah number 4, number 1. So the ayah number 1 and surah number 4. It's almost like the two sisters ayah. So Allah says, it is Him who has created you from a single nafs, so a single entity. وَجَعَلَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. And from her, I'm going to now use the pronouns as they appear in Arabic, وَجَعَلَ مِنْهَا, because it's nafs, its feminine, its soul, its entity, itself. So from her, he made zawjaha, her mate. So what this ayah means is that the first one to have been created is not the female, but it's not the male, but it is rather the female, because Allah created the nafs first, and then he created the male. So the Quran says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in fact created the mother first, and then after her created Adam, but he did not create Adam from her rib or from her hair or from back. No, he created Adam from the same components as the wife. She is from the earth, he is from the earth. Allah used water for her, he used water. So exactly what composed the body, of our mother is exactly the same as that of the father. And this ayah in Surah Al-A'raf, that is ayah number 189, and the Al-A'raf is number 7. The ayah in Surah Al-A'raf fully explains who came first. Alhamdulillah, this ayah sheds full light on this, on Surah An-Nisa. So the first one to have been created is who? Our mother. Then Allah created Adam. Then Allah made the angels prostrate to Adam. Then as soon as the angels finished the prostration to Adam, as soon as the debate finished between Allah and the shaitan, Allah turns to Adam and he tells him, Adam, you and your wife go to Jannah. You see, if Allah had created the wife after Adam, it should have been like this. Adam is the first. Then Allah, what? He made the angels prostrate to him, because he said, as soon as I blow into him. So as soon as Allah blows in Adam life, the angels prostrate, Adam gets their shaitan animosity. Then what? The Bible says in Jannah, Allah causes Adam. Adam was asleep, then Allah in Jannah creates. And this goes against Al-Quran. Al-Quran, it says, it was there and then. So by looking into the Quran, you will always find the answer to what you are looking for. The meaning is further enhanced by another ayah in the book of Allah. When Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ, and of his signs, أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا, that he created for you from your own selves spouses. So, and then he says, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا, and لِتَسْكُنُوا, here he talks to the male. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that of the signs and miracles of Allah is that he created for us from ourselves. Did my wife was born from me, made out of me? No. Min anfusikum, meaning from the same component, something that is out of you, who is like you. So my wife is made from the earth. She is a human. She eats, she drinks, and everything. Another, just to explain this min from, because some people in the books of tafsir has caused a big headache. Allah in Surah Al-Jum'ah, and Surah Al-Jum'ah is the Surah number 62, in the second ayah, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ, it is he who has sent in the Gentiles, that is those who are not Jews, a messenger from themselves. So Allah did not take the messenger from ourselves or from the Sahaba back in time, but it means a messenger that is like them. When Rasulullah ﷺ says, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ, I am just a human like you, it means I come from the same breed, from who you are. It is clear that Rasulullah ﷺ was not created from humans, but rather from, he had the same components as anyone else. So anyone, really, any person who takes the time to look at what Allah says, and as I said, without any presumptions, nothing, you don't bring your issues and you look for the Quran, something that will go with what you believe. You must come with the issue in mind that you want to study and look for, and then you approach the Quran with nothing at all, with an open heart, with a clear, clean heart, and you will see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide you, will hold your hand and guide you to that absolute truth. So here in this ayah here, We understand now why Allah says وَبَدَأَ خَلْقَ الْإِنسَانِ مِنْ طِينٍ, and He commenced the creation of the human from mud. The mother, our mother, was created from mud. Our father Adam, both of them were independently created from mud. In fact, the woman was created first, and Adam is the last. Aren't there a hadith that says that Adam was created in the last hour on Jum'ah day? That's why people make dua there. Because if Adam was created at the last, after him there is no other creation. The Bible says in Jannah, but the Quran says no. The woman came first. Then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala terminated her creation, nothing happened with the angels. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam, that's when everything took place as we saw that. So both ayat in Surah An-Nisa, that's Surah number 4, and Al-A'raf number 7, declared that the outside birth of humanity started with the female first, then the male was created, and then from both of them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created many men and women. And also you have to understand the reality. A female is known to be independent and can take care of herself, while the male, we are volatile, we are unstable, and only a female can anchor us, and you have to be a male to know this. In Arabic, the term sakan, which is the dwelling, cannot be used unless the person is married. I can live in a mansion and I am single, that is just called bait, a house. But as soon as the person gets married, in Arabic they don't call it bait anymore, they call it sakan. And the Arabs, if you say ana askunu, I live peacefully in a place, they understand you are married, and that's because of the ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, litaskunu ilayha. So that we live in that. Regrettably and very sadly, our books are filled with matters that directly contradict the teachings of Al-Quran, and obviously Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is innocent from so many ahadith. Abu Huraira is innocent from so many ahadiths that have been said and attributed to him. Al-Bukhari and Muslim are also, as I said, we don't have the original books, so we cannot go back to what's original to double check. So anything that is added there that doesn't agree with the Quran does not necessarily mean that Abu Huraira or Abdullah ibn Abbas deliberately added them, but somebody else has added them in the name and used the name of Abdullah ibn Abbas or Abu Huraira and things like that. And before, the Arabs, they used to do that a lot, and even today they write books but they never ever put their own names, they put names of other things. It's really painful, as I said, to find in the tafsir of At-Tabari and other books that it is the woman who ate first and then the man followed, and this is exactly biblical when an Al-Quran Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala openly has said that they both ate from it, they both disobeyed Allah, they both got kicked out of the Jannah and everything. Yes, Adam is responsible because he's the leader of the pack, but this does not innocent him from what he did. To wrap up this very sad issue, which has caused women to suffer greatly under the oppression of the male, really, this abuse is still going on in different parts of the world. It's very sad that the Saudi Arabia, who claim to be so Salafi and so close to the root of Islam, are the worst people on earth, both in treating women, in treating people that work for them, in everything. You go and live in Saudi Arabia and you will hear some stories, and you would think like you are on the 17th centuries when they were slaves and all that kind of stuff. It's unbelievable how people, and I find it really strange that people who preach the Salafi world and the movement and the ideology and the belief and things like it's the ideal thing in Islam, when actually the leaders of Salafism, Saudi Arabia, are the crooks of the world, are the most people that have used religion for political ends, for gain, for employment, for jobs. How can we, it goes beyond my head that we Muslims can't see the reality. It's kind of like we preach what's on paper. When it comes to reality, even it's bad, it's evil, it's vile, it's horrible, it's okay as long as on paper it looks good. You wouldn't buy a house that on paper looks good and in reality looks completely different than what's on paper. Well, the Salafism and the Islam we're selling today is exactly like that. It's a house that looks nice on paper, but in reality it's the worst house ever. There is nothing good about it. The world these days will make fun of us. Ha! In the 21st century, Muslim women in Saudi Arabia, the highest country that is so close to the Sunnah, have started. Wallahi, it's really funny. So, my dear sisters and my brothers, the way it is today happening in the world is that the male in the Muslim society, in Salafism and the Wahhabism in Saudi Arabia and parts of the world where these horrible beliefs are being preached, feels that Allah is his far more than he is for a woman. And this is absolutely a huge lie. Allah is an equal God to both the male and the female. The West has revolted against the control of the organized religion found in churches and synagogues, and women are now have gone to a far extreme. They do what they do, which Allah is not happy with and is not pleased with, but women have taken like the extreme of how they were before. And the next thing that's going to happen is, guess what? The Muslims are going to revolt against the mosque, the Islamic societies, organizations and centers, and it has started. The scholars, especially in Saudi Arabia, that were before presented like angels, that the companions. I remember once somebody said, Al-Fawzan is a companion walking amongst us today. And Al-Fawzan, where is he today? What has he done that is good for the Muslim world except qualifying us all as kafir because we don't follow his own thinking? Just because we don't believe that Allah has a physical hand like you and mine, he makes me a kafir. No, I'm sorry. This is not how the cookie crumbles. There is a lot of oppression in the Muslim world, and the root of that oppression comes exactly from where the church brought it from, is that they believe at very core, their very core, that the woman is the reason why Adam disobeyed Allah, why he ate from the tree, why, i.e., the woman is responsible for the misery of man. And this is untrue. Women are beautiful creatures out there, just like you are beautiful creatures out there. Both of us are on earth for a purpose, and that purpose is Allah has explained the Quran to create progenies and to take care of the earth and just show what we are capable of, that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put into us. Adam and his wife were created at the same time with the woman before the man. Then Adam was created. Then when Allah finished Adam's creation, he commanded the angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, then commanded Adam to take his wife and go to the garden. Then there was the mention of the shaitan and. Life is good with this understanding. And of course, the truth is that women were before us will not please the wife beaters and the women haters. It's not gonna please them at all. But again, as I said, maybe what I say today will not make much hoo-ha in the Muslim world, but sometime somewhere in the near future, inshallah, when the next Muslim generations will start searching far beyond what's being preached to us, because what's being preached to them is not fulfilling, and maybe one day somebody will find my talk, maybe they will listen to this and they will like it, and that person there could be a president of a country, could be a big leader, and hopefully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring the changes about in these things. There is a lot that I had to cut here because otherwise it's going to take three or four talks of 1 hour each, and I know you guys are busy, so I just wanted to let you know that alhamdulillah, Al-Quran says that the woman was created first, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the male, that is Adam alayhi salam, and when he created, and you know the sequence, then they went and lived happily in Jannah until a shaitan whispered to them, and then they ate from the tree, both of them, and they disobeyed Allah, and they were both of them chased from Jannah. And here we are on earth today with our ultimate goal is to go back to the Jannah where we were before. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this is clear. Again, if you have any questions, do feel to email me, send me a message on WhatsApp or just through YouTube. You've got my phone number there. There is the email on the poster on the YouTube. And again, you know, if you have anything, inshallah, that you want me to talk about, just again, get in touch. Until then, you be in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is again your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. To be part of the group is 078-7640-8735, or you can just subscribe to my YouTube channel to receive updates as and when the talks are happening. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وصل اللهم على آل بيتك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.